Hey, hey, everybody. It's Eddie from Tokyo. This is your cryptocurrency update from Japan. And do you ever wonder why so many people have things wrong, especially when it comes to Ripple and XRP? Let me explain one of those reasons why. So I'm on the Twitter site of the Crypto Trader. This is Ran Noon, and he is the host of the CNBC Crypto Trader. He has 100,000 followers on Twitter. He gets a fair amount of FaceTime on television as well. He sent this tweet out today. The Binance hack shows that XRP is better than BTC. Here's why. First, the Binance hackers would have paid less than $69 to make the $41 million transfer if they'd used XRP, and that is correct. Secondly, unlike with BTC, CZ could have called someone at Ripple and they would have reversed the ledger. Well, he knows that is not correct. You cannot reverse the ledger. Many people in the XRP community caught him at this tweet, including Tiffany Hayden, who wrote, "You've already been educated on this, so now it becomes libel." He had a chance to rethink what he tweeted, and he deleted his tweet. In addition to that tweet, he also tweeted out that the Binance hackers paid $68.72 to move that $41 million, and the transfer took a few seconds. That's an exaggeration. Please check the facts. Which bank could do that? Well, I can tell you which bank can do that. That is the Siam Commercial Bank. They can do it because they are an XRP user for their cross-border remittances. And not only could they, but would do it faster and cheaper. They are the hub for the Southeast Asian region. They're providing that transfer service. And silly Ran, you should have known this. Your comment kind of makes you look. If we take a look at the transaction cost to protect the XRP ledger from being disrupted by spam or the denial of service attacks, each transaction must destroy a small amount of XRP. And the current minimum transaction cost required by the network for a standard transaction is 0.00001. XRP, which comes out to about 10 drops. And it was on the 1st of January 2019, it was made public that $755 million of XRP was moved in just 4 seconds, and it took less than 1 cent in fees. And here is also an article back in August 2018 when the TechCrunch founder Michael Arrington sent $50 million in Ripple's XRP. It took only 3 seconds and the cost was 30 cents. There are some facts for you, Ran. The Daily HODL wrote today an article that has the headline, "Will Ripple's clients switch from xCurrent to the XRP-powered xRapid?" Another silly question. Of course they will. It ain't the money, it's the money. If you go to Twitter, you will find that David Schwartz, the CTO of Ripple, confirmed on May 6th that 4.0 is live. This means all Ripple customers can integrate XRP, and they can now be powered by xRapid. If they want to stay relevant, if they want to stay competitive, if they want to stay in business, of course they're going to use XRP. And in the last 24 hours, there was a big meeting happening in Chicago, and Ripple was there. Ripple was there as a representative, along with 35 other digital asset firms. And they were at something that's called Quora. Quora is a nonprofit community for the cryptocurrency OTC industry. And they are working very hard to improve compliance and standards to prevent bad actors in this crypto space. So it's reported that they were in a conference room with and I quote, black walls and no windows, discussing. There is one quote that came out of the meeting, and that was a Mr. Nakamura. He is the senior member of the Galaxy Digital Trading Group. And Bloomberg reports that he said that we have to crawl, walk, jog, and then run. And we are now off our knees and onto our feet. So they're working hard, but it looks like it's a little bit of a slow process as to what can be done to keep these situations like that occurred at Binance with this hacking. And there's an increase of bad there's an increase of bad actors in this space. And I'm just happy to see that they're working diligently to improve the space. If you're interested in knowing where these BTC that were stolen from Binance are moving, you can use CoinFirm. CoinFirm, they are security specialists. They're really, really good when it comes to anti-money laundering and know your customer compliance. They have a lot of experts, about 100 people that do data analytics, and they do a lot of research across tech, media, and finance. They were founded by the ex-head of the anti-money laundering division in the Royal Bank of Scotland. So you can see that from their London office and a couple of offices in Poland as well, and also they've got an agent here in Tokyo. They will keep you up to date with how that BTC is moving. I've got my kitty behind my laptop again. Sorry, guys. It's moving a little bit too much. Momo, please stop. So this is a graph that they have created, and you can see where a lot of this BTC is moving. So almost 5,786 BTC, or 34 million, still sit on the Binance hackers' original addresses, but they have more exclusive insights coming. So if you want to follow it, that is the site that I think is going to be best for you. Okay, we are moving to the fluff. Today was the first day that you could register to get your ID to buy tickets for the Tokyo Olympics. And they are doing this issuance of an ID so that they can eliminate people who are going to buy up tickets and sell them for more than they should be selling them. And I think it's probably a good idea because there's a lot of people who will buy up really large groups of tickets that are popular events, and then they'll charge more money for them. And that's just not very fair. So if you get your ID along with the events that you're interested in, you get kind of some priority in getting those tickets ordered. So I decided I want to maybe see, not all of these, but these were my first choices: weightlifting, skateboarding, that one really interests me, gymnastics, equestrian, fencing, handball, badminton, and volleyball. I think those would all be really fun to see in person. And if you are living outside of Japan, because right now it's open only for residents, but if you live outside Japan, there is an official ticket sales operator in your country, and you can get more information. I'll put the link to that down in the description below. I think they're going to keep this fairly restricted and controlled to try and eliminate those bad actors buying up tickets and selling them for more than they originally sold for. And if you come to Tokyo, you may be able to spend some time in a room that is one of the new Internet of Things that are being incorporated with AI. The hotels are starting to really get sophisticated here in Japan to optimize with your relaxation, your enjoyment, and they're combining it with technology. So what do I mean by that? For example, if you're in one of these ultimate bedrooms, there will be some sensors, and those sensors will track your state of sleep, and then they'll control the air conditioner, the humidifier, the lights, the speakers. Even sometimes they're hooked up to some aroma therapy, and even some Panasonic and Simmons bed companies are doing a joint effort to get automatic beds where the bed actually changes the shape and adjusts the firmness to try to get you in your best rest state. So these applications link to your smartphone, and there's a lot of big companies getting behind this technology in Japan because it is costing companies a lot of money. The people who live in Tokyo sleep less than anyone else on the planet. Just 6 hours and 35 minutes, nearly an hour less than the international average. So they have the lowest sleep in the whole world. Interestingly enough, Finland is number one, and also followed by Estonians, Canadians, French, Belgians, Austrians, and Dutch. They get a lot of sleep, but 92% of Japanese say they don't get enough sleep, and they estimate it costs 138 billion in non-productivity for Japanese companies. So Panasonic is stepping up to the challenge, and they are making these smart rooms. So they kind of do a smart kitchen, smart living room and dining room, and smart bedroom baths. And some of the features they have is like this smart mirror. This smart mirror will actually analyze your skin, the condition of your skin, and then offer a product for you on the counter that you can use. And it also will make some suggestions for your makeup, and you can actually see if you do follow that makeup suggestion, you can see what you look like. So it's unbelievable. You can also spin around and it takes a snapshot of the back of your hair, which I think a lot of women appreciate. For the beds, they actually have beds that can track your heart rate, your body temperature, also control the ambient lighting, and you can create a different mood for when you lay down. It senses that you actually are laying down, so the lights will change. You can set the alarm where you wake up to chirping birds or a babbling brook. Yeah, so this technology and this AI is getting very, very sophisticated. And I think you're going to see a lot of it incorporated into the hotel rooms here in Tokyo. So when you come for the Olympics, try to find a smart room. All right, everybody, do take care. Sayonara for now. Bye-bye.